it is to worship together. This next song is a great reminder to us that our circumstances do not need to determine whether or not we praise the Lord. For no matter what comes before us or what goes behind us, we pray that His praise would always be on our lips. So let's sing together. Bless the Lord, O my soul. So grateful that no matter what passes before us, no matter what is following behind us, we know that you are there. We know that you are there to stand strong beside us. We pray that you would open our eyes and our ears and our hearts to hear what you have for us today, that we might be wholly yours. It is in your Son's name we pray. And everybody said, amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, beautiful people.
Good morning, beautiful people.
It is a joy to be with you on this great day that God has given us. I am thankful for the opportunity to be with you on this morning and to share just a few words as we think about what it really means to be the body of Christ, getting ready to do a new thing, hopefully. Yes, ready. And the gift that we may miss is the fact that God has called us together. And the fact that we are here with so much to offer, not only the church, but what we'll offer each other as a gift of the South Central jurisdiction. So I want you to just look at your neighbor for a moment. And I want you to see the really wonderful spirit of the neighbor around you. And I just want you to say, I am glad you are you. Now, if some of you are not that happy this morning of who you are, that's another case. But just knowing you are you. I want to invite you to a text I think is perfect for General Conference delegates and jurisdictional conference delegates. It has something to do with our character clothes and how we are to look as well as live as we begin a journey together. Are you with me? I want to invite you now to Colossians. Paul has stepped in this morning at St. Luke's and has a word for you and for me. And he says this, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, hear this morning, forgive each other, just as the Lord has forgiven you, so that you also must forgive. And above all, here's some good clothing for delegates. Clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you are called into the one body, and be thankful. Now let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom and with gratitude in your hearts. Sing psalms, hymns, like leaning on the everlasting. Spiritual songs to God. Bless God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Do everything, everything, everything. Yes, everything. Yes, it says everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Giving thanks to God the Father through him. The word of God for the people of God. We live in a world today in which folk are absolutely concerned about how they look and what they wear. Some of you spent some time this morning, I'm sure, thinking about what to wear to look just right. And some others said, all right, this is it. This is what you get. But the reality is we live today in a culture that really has dress codes, and we don't like dress codes. But we do know that airlines have dress codes. We know that schools have dress codes. And there's also a dress code in restaurants. So this past year, several people were thrown off, no, I shouldn't say thrown, were asked to leave a flight because they were not dressed with enough on. There were those in a school system who had to ask some kids to go home because they had four-letter words written on their T-shirts. And there are those who've been in restaurants who, because they thought they were shoes but weren't, were asked to find some and to definitely have on a shirt. Dress code is actually important. And Paul says we need to make sure we've got a dress code. And the reality is there's some things we do that are offensive when we don't have the right clothes. Now, I spent some time putting some funds together with my wife to make sure that our grandkids would be dressed to a T for the first day of school a couple of months ago. Some grandparents in here this morning, I've got a witness. And you're still investing in them in other ways also. But on this particular occasion, we got all these pictures, and Allie, my 10-year-old, wanted Poppy to see her in her new dress. She was wearing, I mean, to the nines, topped about everything, and her girlfriends with her, all with dresses on. And so when she got home from school, she said, oh, Mom, I had such a great day, and I feel so good with this. I'm going to keep this dress on all night. and tomorrow I'm going to wear it again. But your mom said, that's not happening. When is it appropriate? When it really is it appropriate to have new clothes and to keep them on? When is it appropriate to have clothes that are new? And what should you wear all the time? That's what Paul gets to in this text this morning. And it's some thinking for us about the dress code of General Conference. Paul suggests that when you are in Christ, there's something about your wardrobe that says that you are looking good not because you've been to Macy's, not because you've been to Nordstrom's, not because you've been to Men's Warehouse, not because you've got Joseph A. Banks on this morning. Has very little to do with the shopping you've done to put something on the outside. But Paul says it's because God has dressed you on the inside with something everybody wants to see you with on. What are you wearing this morning? I want to suggest that what happens at General Conference too often is our clothes have some malfunctions. That too often our clothes are stiff, inflexible, unwilling to change, status quo, and do not have anything to do with looking at the technological changes and adaptive changes needed for this church to become the church God is calling it to be over against the church we want it to be. Too many folk are dressed in their agenda. And what we really need is some folk who are ready to have a dress code that you didn't put on, God put it on you. So I want to ask this morning, who dressed you this morning? Woo! Who dressed you this morning? Paul got a hold of something. And I'm just praying it gets a hold of the General Conference. I know we've heard the story about the fact that we're dying with membership attendance. And yes, we're in trouble when we think about sustaining ministries today. And yes, we are struggling to find our way and to really have a real mission. But the fact of the matter is, if we got the right clothes on, we might actually get to doing something if we stop worrying about what our outside agenda is and look toward the inside agenda that we've been called to be about. And that is, I believe, in the focus of Lovett Weems, that he's right. That our real task, we talk about making disciples, but you can't make something you can't already have said you are a part. So discipling has to mean something's happened to you to become a disciple. But you can't make it. Transformation happens because you've been transformed. And we need to be transformed as a community. So Lovett says, our real task is to bring more people into the fold, to bring more diverse people into the fold, and a newer generation into the fold. And my prayer is that as we think about elections and processes, I hope even this group looks a little bit younger in the future, for the future of the church. Amen. I know I got to get out of the way too. That the reality is the dress code for us this morning and the dress code for General Conference and Jurisdictional Conference really has to do with several things. And so I went to the fashion market and asked Paul, what is it we need? Paul said, remind folk to dress with compassion and some kindness. That as we relate to all the legislative pieces of work, it's not just paper, it's people that we've been called to serve. We are so busy trying to have enough paper, we have forgotten the people, who the paper is about. Willis Johnson, Wellspring Church, you know the story, the tragic death of Michael Brown, and they're marching in Ferguson. And one of our servants goes up and sees an angry guy who really represents life, friends, who's crying, who's in tears, who is angry about what is happening because he lives in such a violent world. And sometimes we forget to talk and even think about folk who live in such disturbing places. That he goes and reaches and he touches his face and he just kind of holds it there and massages the pain away. The church needs to stop and ask, who will we massage the face and take on their pain? Justice today needs to be a part of the kindness and compassion that we'll be voting on at this time, and that we need to be looking at the faces of folk who really represent the body of Christ, who are looking for a place where they can bring their pain and know the pain can be taken away. So anybody here doing some good? The rule says do good with some street clothes on. I sure hope some street clothes show up for General Conference. Not only that of doing good, of compassion, kindness, but I hope there can be some real humility and some real patience. Lord, half of us that get elected, patient people, we want it done like yesterday. We want it to happen quickly. We expect it to happen because this is what we know we need to do. God may be saying, wait. Slow down. You are trying to do it your way when I've got my way coming. So let's get off the map and stop for a moment and begin to look and listen to our brothers and sisters. I love the story of a girl who was getting ready for breakfast with her dad. Her dad's busy just on that laptop going strong, and dad's going, all right, sweetheart, I hear you saying some things, but I'm busy now. I got to get going. She says, no, just a few things I just want to say to you. He says, well, just say it as quickly as you can because I got to go to work. And she says, okay, Dad, I'll say it as fast as I can if you promise to listen as slowly as you can. I think we've been talking about reflective listening, but we've stopped looking at each other while we call ourselves listening. I hope with the humility that we will do what Reuben Job is asking, looking forward in that timely kind of finding the way forward book, when he says that we need to just pause and look at our brothers and sisters in the eyes and take some moments to not only listen, but to look at their story, live into their story, and help to build a story that we can build together. Our story has never been separate from John Wesley's story. Of the poor and the pressed and the ill and the sick and those who need to know, like coal miners, that they have a place. So we're talking about how do we humble ourselves to stop doing so much selfies. Here we are. I'm a delegate. I'm looking good. The picture needs to go this way. The picture needs to go that way. With humility. And with patience, we need to listen and to look and to do no harm. Ultimately, I want to suggest this morning that in these clothes, you wearing them? You got it? That in these clothes this morning, that ultimately, they are clothes wrapped in love. Paul says all of it comes together with love. And in order to have the love of Christ, it means you got to stay in love with Christ. You got to show you're working on the things that God loves through Jesus Christ, that you actually have on garments that love just absolutely flows through. How do you do that? In a very intense environment where we deal with so many issues and so many things are happening, where we're trying to make decisions together and we've all come with our own stuff, we need to take our clothes to the cleaners. And what's the cleaners? It's worship. It's our devotional time. It's our spiritual time. It's our discernment time. It's our conferring time. All of it ought to lead us to be a worshiping community that says, okay, I don't quite understand this. Let's just ask God. That yes, we are disagreeing, and yes, I'm unhappy right now, but let's just go to God in prayer. Let's get our worship right. We go to worship and then we leave it to do business. No, business ought to be impacted by our worship. So I hope the Holy Spirit comes in the General Conference and we get some worship that we take to the legislative session and goes to the second week, that ultimately folk will look and say, praise God from whom all blessings flow. That somehow you'll see a child of God and see that you need to be praying together, talking together, and listening together because you want to stay in love with God. That's God's challenge. You want to be closer to God by being closer to one another. That's how we get things done. You know, I've gone to General Conference forever. I had to admit it was 8 times now, starting this time. That's a long time. And I thought about one of the times in which we were having a lot of discussion. Things were really going really, really poorly, and folk were having all kinds of debates on the floor, and it was really dealing with rules. Why in the world we can't go ahead and just get the rules done, about 5 minutes and move on? Why are there the wordsmiths? Don't elect those folk. We need some folk who are there because they want to really make a difference in the church. We don't need more people who want to study somebody, but who want to change and transform the church. And so there we were going, sitting around these tables, and folk are just feeling down. You can tell the depression in the room. Some were ready to leave, call an alternate in, sick of this. And then all of a sudden, my brother from Central Conference started humming. And I said, what are you doing? He says, well, when we struggle, we start singing to God. And we use it as a time to say, thank you, God. We trust you, God. We love you, God. We need you, God. Hear us, God. We are yours, God. We are your people. My prayer is that when we start messing up, God will clean us up with some clothes that will cause us to ask for forgiveness and reconciliation and healing and hope and love, and that we will so be so busy staying in love with God that we will not do harm, that we'll find ourselves in the place where all of us will be busy about doing so good that when you get home with those smelly clothes, somebody's going to look and say, been to General Conference. Hey, you don't look too beat up. I see some hope. Looks like we've actually accomplished something. I see something. I see the clothes of God. Maybe so. Maybe so. Let us pray. We're so busy trying to clothe everybody else that we just need you to clothe us, Lord. Many of us have come with a lot of fears and anxieties and concerns, and it's not only about the church, it's just about living, just making it from day to day. I'm concerned that my 10-year-old will have a church that she will grow into, and she'll know that she'll not have to worry about keeping that dress on, but that she'll have a church where she will have your clothes, and she'll grow to be your disciple, and then she'll speak it to the generation and to the next generation and the next generation until all of a sudden we all look more like you, with hymns and songs and praise and thanksgiving and spirit and holiness. All from you. Ah, thank you for already helping us look good. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you. God bless you. Wonderful. I just wanted for a benediction. Turn to a neighbor and say, you're looking good this morning, and pass the peace.
Great, great job. A word we needed to hear. Very, very much. We knew you would do a great job.
It's hopeless. We do have an exciting agenda for us this morning. I hope that you're taking time to have your cup of coffee or whatever else that you would like this morning. We do have several things that are going to be on our agenda that we need to be taking care of. First of all, we wanted to make sure that we talked about judicial council. We have so many first-time delegates. Half of them, they were here, are first-time delegates. Things happen at General Conference quickly, and they just suddenly will start coming at you, and you're being asked to make very significant decisions, and sometimes we really aren't prepared for the things we're being asked to vote on. And it was believed that that's one of those things that we are not always prepared to vote on, is our judicial council. Names are going to come before you, and there's a good chance you will not know those names. And yet you're being asked to make a decision, sometimes based on just a few lines. And so I was even thought, you know, judicial council has an incredible impact on us. We worry so much about who are our bishop candidates, and we go through all this time interviewing them, and you look at what bishops try to do, and then you look at the impact that judicial council has had on the last general conference and throughout this last quadrennium, and they've made many significant, far-reaching decisions. Many you may... Excuse me, you may feel very good about, you may not like them, but regardless of whether you like them or dislike them, there have been so many significant decisions. And so I think it is important that we take the time, if you have liked the decisions, you need to know who is on judicial council and you probably want to support them again. If you have not liked the decisions, you probably need to know who is on judicial council and not support them next time. That really is how this free legislative process works. But knowing is the critical issue, and understanding who is making decisions that have far-ranging effects on the things that we are doing. Deciding to set that aside, we asked that Jay Brim would be willing to talk to us about the judicial council, for us to be able to understand how nominations come. Maybe we have people who are being nominated from the South Central jurisdiction. Maybe we have to find ways that we understand who people are so we can be voting with intentionality and clarity. Jay Brim is someone, those of us who've been doing this for a little while know Jay. Everybody knows Jay. Jay's been doing this a real long time, a lot longer than I have. And, you know, we did this conference here at St. Luke's 4 years ago, for the first time here in this part of the country, but we did it because of Jay. Jay had actually come up with this idea and had tried it down more in Southwest Texas, and many people felt it was just very difficult to drive to get to, and so Jay came and said, Bob, why don't you do it more in Oklahoma City, a more central location, and maybe more people will come. And so this idea of what we are doing is not mine. It is Jay Brim's who actually came up with this and encouraged us to try to pull something like this together. As I said, 78% of all the delegates made the effort to come and be a part of this. And so, Jay, we thank you for helping to dream up something like this that we're doing. Thank you very, very much. On top of all that, Jay, I did not know until this morning, 50 years ago, was the head cheerleader at the University of Texas. Hook 'em horns, go Jay. All right.
I'm glad he emphasized that 50 years ago, and I've been doing this a really long time. Can't get a walker up on this stage, Bob. We were truly blessed this morning with our opening worship, and especially those words from Reverend Collier. And I think y'all all need to know what a debt we owe the people of the Missouri Conference for having sent Cody Collier to us repeatedly now for at least four quadrennia. Many of us here in the room have served on the Jurisdictional Episcopacy Committee with him, and we can tell you that it is because of Cody we have the best process for assigning bishops in the entire denomination, because Cody taught us how to do it with love and respect and a need to improve the whole jurisdiction, not to take care of anybody's political needs on any one section of the jurisdiction. So, Cody, we are so thankful for your ministry because you have applied it, not just spoken it so well, but you've applied it. Thank you, sir. And he's said some words. You notice I didn't bring the Bible up here. I brought the lawyer's book. And I was thinking as he was saying that about what we're about to do at General Conference and paraphrasing our liturgy, these are the words chosen by the delegates for the people represented by the delegates. But we all have to wonder, when it's all over, will there be thanks to the delegates for what we do? And what we're going to talk about today is a good indication of that. Chapter 26, or chapter 7 of the Book of Discipline, the 2,600 paragraphs, cover the Judicial Council. And when it was originally written back there in 1968, it included a very specific way, which has been rewritten since 2000, for the selection of these delegates. And that's what Bob has asked me to get up here and talk to you about. I'm not going to talk about any individual on the council. I don't think that's appropriate. But what we do think is important is that we be, all of us, thinking about this in advance of General Conference and being ready to deal with this decision when it comes before us. In the coming General Conference, we're going to be electing three laity and two clergy members to the council of nine members. So we will be electing a majority of the Judicial Council this coming time. The way the process works, the Council of Bishops chooses a slate of candidates that will be put before General Conference 24 hours before the vote. And that slate will include three times the number of members to be elected to the council for each of the two groups. So there's going to be nine laypersons nominated by the Council of Bishops and six clergy persons. I'll say in an aside here, it's my personal hope that the council is so wise as to include Reverend Tim Brewster at the top of their list, since he has served as first alternate delegate this time, and first alternate member to the Judicial Council, and served winningly in a number of decisions that we've seen. Tim, thank you for your service, and here's hoping we... Of course, that's not an endorsement, because we don't do that here. But here's something you got to remember as we get ready to go to Portland and do this deed. The Book of Discipline does not allow discussion of the candidates. Now, for all you first-time delegates, think about what that means. You're going to see a strange list of names put up on the big board in front of us, a long list of people that most of us will not know, and we're going to be asked to choose these folks. Now, the Judicial Council, for those of you that haven't given much thought to it, is the Supreme Court of the United Methodist denomination, and it is truly supreme. There is no appeal from every decision made by this council, which is the same way the U.S. Supreme Court works, except that Congress can overrule decisions of the Supreme Court in all matters except those that are constitutional, and it's literally possible to do that within days of time from when a U.S. Supreme Court decision is made. It has happened that Congress has overruled a decision that it found particularly difficult, or where the courts pointed out that Congress made a mistake and something needed to be fixed. Unfortunately for us, General Conference is the only place where a decision of the council can be changed, and that's usually going to happen 4 years later, or some period of years later. And with all of the complexities of our General Conference polity of legislative choice, we have a really difficult situation dealing with decisions made by the council that
as all of us that were Tampa remember, come in a moment when there is no way to backtrack and fix something. And we have a really difficult time choosing our Judicial Council members because we have very little time to talk about them. I'm the chancellor of the Rio Texas Conference now, and I can tell you that the chancellor group, the conference chancellors, are extremely concerned about this. And at our last annual meeting, we held an extended, open conversation among all of the chancellors present. And there are about 70 in the United States. And it was almost universally agreed that we've got to find a way to ensure that members of the Judicial Council have some understanding of the role of, I hate to use the word conservative choice, but what we want to avoid is an activist approach by our council when we have no way of backtracking on their decisions. What we need is a careful review with an eye to precedent, which most often the council does, but with the understanding that they cannot go outside the boundaries of the discipline. We cannot allow these decisions to become a matter of personal choice. Now, here's the difficulty. The council is most often not made up of persons who are trained in law. Many of you would say that's a good thing. And it is in many ways. We want Christians. We want people who are dedicated to our way. You know, I teach my Sunday school class, and I love to talk about Saul of Tarsus because I see him as the first great lawyer in the Bible. He was a scribe and a Pharisee, which of course made him a lawyer in the temple there in Jerusalem. And so I see myself as Saul of Tarsus, and Paul, of course, was just a recovering lawyer. So I'm hoping someday to follow in his footsteps. But back to where we are. Frankly, we do need more lawyers, not a majority, but we need enough lawyers on the council, I believe, so that they understand the ways that precedent guides the council. Bob and I have talked at length about how to delicately touch on this subject, and again, as I said, I'm not going to talk about any member of the council. I'm just going to tell you we're going to elect a majority of the council coming up at the next in Portland. And what's important for all of us is that we be aware as delegates and we work with everybody around us, not just in this jurisdiction, but everywhere, to become aware of who these candidates are. We talked among the chancellors about how you would run somebody. And there were several stories cited where it just doesn't work. This is not a race where we welcome people running for the office, and that's appropriate, I think. The difficulty is walking the fine line between not having a political circus to select people to the council, but on the other hand, knowing who we are electing. And in our conversations, Bob and Judy and I, we thought about the best way to do that is just simply to make sure everybody here realizes that going to Portland sometime at the beginning of the second week, we're going to suddenly see a list of people. And then what we need to do is dedicate the 24 hours between the time we see that list of people and the time we actually vote to make sure we're all aware of who the most qualified candidates are, who can ensure that we're not going to have any problems down the road with judicial activism from our council. With that in mind, the chancellors are also putting forward some legislation that are going to put some, we hope, limitations on what the council does. In particular, there is a petition going forward that will prohibit the awarding of attorney's fees by the council. This jurisdiction needs to know that the council, and the only time that any of us are aware of, awarded attorney's fees against the South Central jurisdiction in a case and required the Mission Council to pay $85,000, I believe, to an attorney. You'll find if you look through most of the provisions in the discipline that lawyers aren't even allowed to speak in church trials. That is not true at the Judicial Council level. And I certainly agree that having someone who understands how to advocate in an appropriate way and how to present arguments is a good idea at that level of the church. But there certainly is no reason for us to use mission dollars to pay attorney's fees. And I hope when y'all see the chance to vote for that, that you'll step forward and make your vote count to put that prohibition in place. I think that's all I can do for you on this morning, and hopefully I'll become a Christian by the next time I speak to you.
Jay, you just need to know, we believe you are truly a Christian and a lawyer. We're grateful to you very, very much. It is a very complex issue, and that challenge of knowing. And, you know, I've got to confess my sins of those early times of going to General Conference, and those names had come up, and I sat there and did not know a thing about those names and had to make a decision on who to vote for Judicial Council. The way the system is set up just does not help you be prepared. And yet we see time after time how critical it is, and we've got to find a way that we can be prepared for that moment when we elect such an important thing. Thank you, Jay, very, very much. Now let me tell you what I thought we might try to do today. I know that it's raining. It's going to be raining all day long, heavy outside, and I know that many of you are driving and traveling. The way that we're set up, I thought that if we could skip this next conferencing and break. There's not a lot to conference about on Judicial Council at this moment, and go straight on into pensions and divestment. Then we could break and have a holy conferencing and have a break at that time. We are very fortunate to come back and be able to have Kim Simpson with us, as well as Rena Yoakum, to be talking to us about a very important procedural a rule that is going to be invoked at General Conference this time, as well as some things that are going to be new at General Conference for delegates and how we're going to be living this out. So we have an important thing to come back and deal with, but I thought if we could just go ahead and move on to Dave. If you need a break and want to get something to drink, feel free to get up and do that. But if we could move into Dave's presentation, I think that would help us with our time. One of the important things that came up at General Conference this last time was the issue of the Israelis and the Palestinians and the conflict there in the Middle East, and the issue of how do we as a church be involved in this in some sort of a positive way to be enacting something that helps to make the situation better. Dave Zellner is the Chief Investment Officer for the General Board of Pensions and Health Benefits. He just was on a trip there too. Israel, to Palestine, to see what was going on. This is not the first. They've made multiple ones, but he literally is just back from there. And so we thought it would be very helpful to have Dave come and to talk to you about the situation and the groups that are asking for divestment and why and what is the situation, as well as to talk about fossil-free UMC. There has been a movement that has gone on to encourage the General Board to divest from all energy companies in your pension program. Actually, there has been many conferences on the East Coast and the West Coast that approved this as a conference, a recommendation to General Conference that we would do that. The only place it failed was the Great Plains Conference, who refused to endorse fossil-free UMC here in the Midwest, and no one else was approached about it. So again, I wanted you to understand what are the issues, because you will be asked to deal with this at General Conference. If you're a new delegate, what you're going to discover is, as you come walking up, you're always being handed flyers and people are there to talk to you, and these are the kinds of issues that are going to be coming your way. I'm very grateful to Dave that he was willing to come down from Chicago to be here today to talk to us, and Dave, we're grateful to hear you.
I think we're on. Good morning, everyone. Thanks, Bob. And thank you all for inviting the General Board of Pension and Health Benefits to come and present to you today regarding the divestment petitions that are going to be presented at General Conference. What I'd like to do is divide my presentation into really three sections. The first section, I'd like to tell you about the General Board in its governance model. I'd like to, in how we go about making sustainable investments. We do have some petitions that we are sponsoring, and you have in your materials information regarding the petitions that we're sponsoring regarding the divestment. But most of the time I want to spend is talking about the various petitions that have been presented, that will be presented at General Conference, that deal with the Israeli occupation, and as Bob said, with fossil-free UMC. But I know that many of you are not necessarily familiar with the work of the General Board of Pension and Health Benefits. So I thought it would be helpful to start out to tell you about our organization and what it is that we do. We are an administrator, fiduciary, and investor on behalf of 92,000 participants, both active and retired, clergy and lay employees of the United Methodist Church. We manage about $20 billion in assets. We're the single largest religious pool of benefit investments in the U.S. And we issue 35,000, 36,000 monthly benefit checks. Over the last 10 years, we've issued about $7 billion in benefit payments. Of course, we are governed by church law. We look to the Book of Discipline, the Book of Resolutions, to help us determine what it is that we need to do to prudently manage the investments for our participants. With regard to sustainable investments, paragraph 1504 is addressing the work of the General Board of Pension and Health Benefits, and it requires that we act as a prudent fiduciary on behalf of all of our participants. It's not a majority. We can't do what the majority wants us to do. We have to do what is in the benefits of every single one of our participants. So first and foremost, we must be a prudent fiduciary. Now, when it comes to aligning investments with the values of the church, we look to paragraph 717. It's currently titled Socially Responsible Investments. But the most important words of 717 is to make a conscious effort. It doesn't direct us to invest in a socially responsible manner, but it asks us to make the best effort that we can to align our investments with the values of the church. And I'll talk about a little bit more about that in a second. So I've used the term sustainable investments. We are intentionally moving away from the terminology of socially responsible investments. So I'd like for you to think for a second. If someone were to ask you, what does socially responsible investment mean, how would you reply? If someone were to say, tell me what it means when the church is a socially responsible investor, well, you'd probably start out by saying, well, you know, there are certain products or services that are not aligned with church values. Alcohol, tobacco, gambling, weapons, pornography. And what we want to do is invest in a way that avoids exposure to those types of products and services. More than likely, you're going to talk about avoidance. But think about the mission of the United Methodist Church. It's to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. How does exclusions align with the mission of the church? I don't know that it does. So we want to transform the language. If we want to transform the world, we need to transform the language. So we have purged the terminology socially responsible investment from any of the language that we use. We've taken it out of our investment policy. When we talk to people, we don't talk about socially responsible investing because it brings to mind the idea of exclusions. We want to be transformative. And so that's why we're focusing on sustainable investing. Ultimately, the goal of sustainable investment is to strengthen the viability for our pension plans. We want to think long term. When a newly ordained clergy enters work of the church, that person and their beneficiaries could be associated and could be receiving benefits from us for up to 80 years. So we have to think long term. And the focus of sustainable investment is to think long term. Now, in administering a sustainable investment program, the focus is on environment, social, and governance issues. Again, it's about transformation. It's about shifting the market. It's about convincing companies and those that have responsibility for our investments to think long-term, that their policies need to consider the impact that their practices and business policies have on the environment, on how they interact with the community, and on proper governance. Now, I wanted to show you pictures of the sustainable investment team because Reverend Collier talked earlier about we need to move to the next generation. And I do think that the people that are helping to administer our sustainable investment program is the next generation. And these are several of the people that are involved directly in ensuring that our program is sustainable and responsible. I feel really good about the fact that we have a diverse group. Four of these people were not born in the United States. One is the son of immigrants to the United States. Both groups are headed by women. So first, let's talk about the sustainable investment strategies. There are four sustainable investment strategies that we use: ethical exclusions, active ownership, positive impact in, investments, and then ESG integration. Of course, we will continue to exclude companies that are not aligned with the values of the church. We exclude alcohol, tobacco, gambling, weapons, pornography, and private prisons. That accounts for about 3-4% of the investment universe. But the most important element of our program is active ownership. And it's working to talk to companies to persuade them to change their business policies and practices to be more aligned with sustainable investment policies and practices. And so I want to give you an example. The example I want to talk about is Hershey's. Now, this was not an issue that we determined was something that we had to focus on. It was actually brought to our attention by United Methodist Women. They said to us, did you know that you have significant ownership in Hershey's? Did you know that Hershey's sources a significant amount of their chocolate from countries that use child labor? Did you know that that's not a sustainable business practice? In all honesty, we had to answer, no, we didn't know that. And so we started to analyze, we started to look into the company and talk to the company and realize that they were involved in non-sustainable practice of sourcing cocoa from countries that utilize child labor. As a result of direct negotiations with Hershey's in combination and partnership with the United Methodist Women, Hershey's agreed immediately to begin sourcing cocoa for its Bliss line from fair trade sources. It made a commitment that by the year 2020, all of its chocolate would be sourced from fair trade sources. The company has reported that it is even ahead of schedule, that it is likely to implement fair trade sources for its cocoa before 2020. That's the type of work that we do. And there are other companies that we have actively pursued shifting the market, changing business practices to be more aligned with the values of the church to have a more sustainable world. We don't just talk to companies, we talk to governments, because we realize that if you try to convince one company to change a business practice that makes it uncompetitive, that it's difficult for them to do so because other companies have unsustainable practices. So there are times where we'll go to governments or world agencies to try to convince them to make changes that will be more sustainable. We don't do this by ourselves. We have a number of partners both in the United States and throughout the world that we use to help bring about change. Then there's positive impact investments. Remember, the only responsibility of ours is to act as a prudent fiduciary. So this is not a handout program. We make viable investments that have a positive impact. We've started this, it's been 25 years since we started our program. We've invested or committed to invest almost $2 billion. The type of things that we invest in are affordable housing, health facilities, charter schools, and microfinance to help entrepreneurs, mostly women, in underdeveloped countries to become entrepreneurs and fund their businesses. In addition, it's important that we have diverse vendors that provide us services. And so we engage investment management firms that have been founded and owned by women and ethnic minorities. So now let's talk about General Conference and the work that's taking place and the petitions that are going to come up at General Conference. Very briefly, I want to talk about the petitions that we're sponsoring. Remember, I talked about purging the terminology of socially responsible investment because what it means, because what it signifies. It's about exclusions and not about making things better. So the first recommendation, the first petition, is to adjust paragraph 717. Instead of calling it socially responsible investing, we want to call it sustainable investment. That's what we're recommending. And there's also some additional changes in paragraph 717 that we are recommending, and there's information in your packets that you received that talk about that. We've also proposed changes to resolution 4071. Again, we want to de-emphasize the exclusions and emphasize what it is that we can do through investments in the United Methodist Church to make a difference, to make a change. And that's what the focus is in resolution 4071. So now I'll talk about the two calls for divestment that Bob talked about. Calls for divesting from companies that are profiting from the occupation in Israel-Palestine, and then calls for screens regarding fossil fuel divestments. First of all, regarding Israel-Palestine, there is a group of United Methodists, and there may be members in this group that belong to United Methodist Kairos Response. The Kairos Palestine document was issued a number of years ago. It was a cry for help from Palestinian Christians who talked about how their human rights are frequently abused at the hands of the Israeli Defense Forces. And it asks Christians around the world to stand in solidarity with the Palestinians to bring about change, to end the occupation. And it talks about nonviolent means to do so. Those nonviolent means center around the concept of boycott, divestment, and sanctions. So United Methodist Kairos Response has offered four resolutions. The first deals solely with Caterpillar. At the 2012 General Conference, there was a petition to divest from companies associated with the occupation. That petition was amended not to divest, but to ask the General Board of Pension and Health Benefits, as well as other United Methodist investors, to work with companies to have them adopt something called the UN Guiding Principles on Business and Human Rights, otherwise known as the Ruggie Principles. It asked us to meet with companies and convince them to adopt those principles. Caterpillar, so far, we've not given up, but so far they have not adopted the guiding principles for business and human rights. And so the first petition says we should divest, sell all of our shares in Caterpillar because they have not signed the guiding principles and they continue to be involved in the Israeli occupation. One thing that I need to describe regarding Caterpillar's involvement is Caterpillar does not sell directly to the Israeli Defense Forces. Caterpillar sells its tractors to the U.S. State Department. The U.S. State Department, in turn, gives the tractors to Israel under a military aid program. The second petition asks, and this is consistent with a petition that was submitted in 2012, asked the General Board specifically to divest from Caterpillar, Motorola Solutions, and Hewlett-Packard. I've described what it is that Caterpillar does. Motorola Solution provides radar detection devices that are used in the settlements that help provide security. That's their involvement. Hewlett-Packard has biometric monitoring, similar to what you might experience when you go through airport security. It has biometric monitoring that's used to screen Palestinians that pass from the occupied territories into Israel. The Israeli Defense Forces do not require that Israeli citizens go through the same screening process, and so this is viewed as unfair, unequal treatment. A third petition is asking to screen, to develop a screen. So I talked about that we have ethical exclusions, alcohol, tobacco, gambling, etc. The third asks for us to adopt a screen to remove any companies that have involvement with the settlements. And then the fourth petition calls for the, I cannot read that. You can read it. So I need to talk about the boycotts and divestments and sanction movements, because when people are talking about divestment, they won't necessarily tell you what the boycott, divestment, and sanctions is asking for. They'll tell you about the very first element, which is to end the occupation immediately and to remove the settlements. Israel has continued to expand into the West Bank, into the Jordan Valley. There are about 400,000 Israeli citizens that have built, quote, settlements in the West Bank. Now again, think about what a settlement might look like. And I can tell you that my own impression was completely dismissed when I saw the true settlements. I mean, these are master planned communities with high-rise condominium buildings and shopping centers and swimming pools and palm trees. This is not like any settlement that you would envision. It looks like a very modern suburb in the U.S. And those settlements are continuing to expand into area that was acquired after the 1967 war. And so the first demand is that the settlements are removed and the Palestinians are given back the land to which that they had prior to the 1967 war. The second is to provide equal rights to Arab citizens of Israel. There has been a lot of discussion that the Arab Israeli citizens of Israel aren't treated fairly, and that there are laws that treat them differently, that treat Jewish citizens differently from Arab Israeli citizens. I've done a lot of research, and while there clearly is discrimination, just like there's discrimination in this country, I haven't yet found a law that says a Israeli Jewish person has rights that an Arab Israeli citizen doesn't have rights. But nevertheless, this won't be discussed very much. What will be discussed are the settlements. The third and perhaps the most contentious issue that prevents attainment of peace in the Middle East is the right of return. And the right of return says that any Palestinian that was dislocated in 1948 when the State of Israel was formed, those individuals and their descendants have a right to return to their land that was displaced. And in all of the negotiations that have taken place to try and achieve peace, ultimately it came down to the right of return as a negotiating point that the parties could not resolve. The reason why is because there are now about 6 million Palestinian descendants from those that were either voluntarily or forcibly removed in 1948. If Israel were to acquiesce to the right of return, then for all intents and purposes, the State of Israel would no longer exist. And so that has been this whole issue is very complicated. The more and more I study it, the more and more complicated it becomes. But the right of return is a very important issue that needs to be discussed, but will unlikely be discussed when you are hearing debates about Israel, the Israeli occupation. So I've talked about the three companies. In addition, there's one annual conference that has passed a resolution asking us to divest from General Electric. General Electric is also involved. So in talking about why those companies, why have we identified those three specific companies, or fourth in the case of General Electric, to divest from? The last time I was in Israel, I talked with Omar Barghouti, who is one of the founders of the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanction movement. I asked him, so why did you pick those three companies? Are those the worst offenders? His response was, of course they're not the worst offenders. Microsoft and Intel are by far the worst offenders in Israel that are perpetuating the occupation. And so I asked him, why not go after Microsoft and Intel? Why are you starting with Caterpillar? Because if we went off after Microsoft and Intel, we wouldn't win. We want to go after companies that we think we have a reasonable chance of winning. What we're trying to do is bring attention to what's going on here. And if you divest from Caterpillar, Motorola, Hewlett Packard, you bring attention to the problem that we're having. So then I ask him, so then you're saying that it's symbolic? And his response of course it's symbolic. Again, what we're trying to do is bring attention to what's going on here and the fact that our human rights are being violated. And I can tell you from being there, human rights are being violated. But then I would also say making symbolic gestures is not consistent with our charge to be prudent investors on behalf of all of our participants. Caterpillar is very much present in the Palestinian territories. This is a picture of a Caterpillar dealership in Bethlehem, and we did see Caterpillar equipment used in a Palestinian road project when we were there. There have been other companies that have also been identified as being involved with the Israeli occupation. And here is a sample of companies that have been identified. Now, Cairo's response has been very clear in saying that these are not currently targets for divestment, but they have identified how these companies are benefiting from the occupation, and there's a list of these as well as a number of other companies that are involved. So what are we at the General Board doing? We have avoid, engage, and investment strategies with regards to human rights. With regard to avoid, we have policies that look around the world at countries that have unsustainable policies and practices that violate human rights. And where companies have significant exposure in those areas, we endeavor to avoid investing in those companies. But what we want to do is we want to engage with companies. We want to inform them and educate them about how we believe their business practices are not sustainable and how their business practices could potentially perpetuate human rights violations in those countries. That's our preferred course of action. Okay, now I'm going to talk about fossil fuel divestment. In the case of fossil fuel divestments, the proponents, which is fossil-free UMC, I believe have taken a much more strategic approach. They do not specifically call on the General Board to divest. They have not submitted a resolution that says require the General Board to divest from fossil fuel companies. They've taken a more strategic approach. First of all, what you see now is a picture from their website. The landing page on their website is to tell the General Board of Pension and Health Benefits that it's time to go fossil free. And the rationale is that it's wrong to profit from wrecking the planet. The belief is that companies that are producing fossil fuels are producing products that are putting carbon into the atmosphere that is raising the Earth's temperature, and that would be unsustainable for future generations. Once temperatures go above 2 degrees centigrade from where they were at the beginning of the 20th century, then human life as we know it will be transformed forever, and there will be a lot of catastrophes similar to the type of weather events that we've been seeing over the last few years. So the first petition creates a fossil fuel investment screen. So just like paragraph 717 now talks about alcohol, gambling, and weapons, the first petition adds a screen that United Methodist institutions should make a conscious effort to avoid investment in fossil fuel companies. The second petition amends the language in paragraph 407.1, which is similar to 717, which again adds the production of petroleum, coal, and natural gas to the list of excluded industries. The third petition asks that we have socially responsible investment strategies that don't invest in companies that derive significant revenue, 10% or more, from fossil fuels. So what action has the General Board take? Again, we have a policy of avoid, engage, and invest. The first is avoid. We recognize that the world is shifting away from the use of coal. You don't have to believe in climate change. You don't have to believe that it was caused by man. But you have to recognize that there are a lot of people in the world that do believe that. And if you've been to China and if you've seen the pollution caused by the burning of coal, and knowing that the Chinese are desperate to transform from the consumption of coal. And we here in the United States have put policies and practices in place to avoid coal. It's very apparent that continued production of coal is not going to be sustainable. And so in recognizing that, we chose to avoid investing in companies that produce coal. And so that is already being done. We've excluded coal because we believe that it is a bad investment. We believe that to continue to invest in coal is not in the best interest of our participants. So that's strategy number one. The second is to engage. And we've been very active working with our other partners to engage various political organizations, governments, non-governmental organizations, the United Nations, to focus on transforming to a less carbon-intensive economy, and to work with companies to persuade them to rely less on fossil fuel in their productions. Apple Computer, for example, has committed to sourcing all of its electricity from renewable sources. And so this is an approach that we have been taking to convince the companies that continuing to rely on fossil fuels is not likely a sustainable strategy. And then we also invest in low carbon energy solutions. We currently invest in Tesla, First Solar, Vestas, which produces windmills, and we think this is another way to position ourselves in a sustainable and responsible manner. So in conclusion, we think that the problems are real. As Bob told you, I've been to the Middle East twice. I've witnessed for myself the human rights abuses that are occurring in the Palestinian territories. It's definitely a problem. It definitely is a problem that has been fixed. It needs to be fixed. It is a very complicated problem, and there has been attempts over the years to try and resolve and find solutions to the problem. Those solutions haven't been found yet, and we pray and hope that they will be found soon. We just don't believe that divestment is going to solve the problem. We know that others have taken efforts to divest, and still the problems have not changed. We think that engaging with companies is a more practical solution to teach them and educate them about what practices they have are unsustainable. We think that divestment silences our voice. When we sell our shares, we no longer have a right to sit at the table and convince companies to change their business practices. And we also do believe that we can make investments that will have a positive impact. So that concludes my formal remarks, and we have some time for questions. And so now I would like to open it up for questions.
Leslie Broadbent, Oklahoma Conference. And so if these are all of the issues with divesting, I'm wondering why you're calling for divesting. I mean, those were the concerns that I had as well about divesting. Are there instances where divesting changed the practices of a company? I mean, I know that we've taken some credit for Hershey's changing some of their practices. I wonder if divesting has ever done that, or do we need to continue to have a relationship with these companies so that we would be able to have some say in what they do.
Thank you. So the question is, has divestment ever led to a change in company business practices? What both the United Methodist Kairos response, as well as Fossil Free UMC, will argue is that divestment was used in the case of South Africa, and that divestment was effective in the case of South Africa ending apartheid. Now, that is subject to debate. I mean, the fact is that there were a lot of organizations, including the General Board of Pension and Health Benefits and other religious institutions, that divested from companies that were involved in South Africa. And it is true that South Africa ended apartheid. Well, whether or not there was cause and effect there is certainly subject to debate. We do know that there were companies that had business in South Africa that were subject to boycotts, and they lost business. And those companies, because they had lost significant business due to boycott, withdrew their activities from South Africa. In the case of South Africa, we need to be very clear that the policies that we put in place at the time was to ask companies to adopt the Sullivan principles. The Sullivan principle said that if you operate in South Africa, that you need to treat all of your employees equally. You can't have policies for white South Africans and different policies for black South Africans, because we just thought that that was an unsustainable business practice. Companies that adopted the Sullivan principles, we continued to invest in. Companies that refused to sign the Sullivan principles, we divested from. But again, I personally don't believe that divestment is what caused the change in policies in South Africa. I think it was the collective work of governments and organizations around the world, and to a certain extent the boycotts, that ultimately resulted in the end of apartheid. Another question.
Shayla Jordan, Great Plains Annual Conference. I saw that when you talked about the fossil fuels, you talked about what you would do instead of investing in them. And I may have missed it, but I didn't catch what you guys, is there any thought to what companies you would invest in if you were to divest in Caterpillar, Motorola, and Hewitt?
So the question is if we were forced to divest from Caterpillar, Motorola Solutions, and Hewlett-Packard, would we replace that with something else? And yes, we would, but those decisions are ultimately made by the investment managers that we hire. So if we were forced to sell those shares, the investment managers would have additional cash. They would make decisions on what investments to make, and it could be anything. I would not be able to answer what specific companies they would purchase. Next, yes.
With regard to divestment, is there any precedent of the General Conference taking action to divest from a specific company or specific companies?
Thank you, Steve. So the answer is no, that there's no specific precedent. One of the issues that I didn't discuss is accountability for investment decisions. Currently, Bob Long, who is on our board, Melba, who's also on our board, Teresa Keese, other members that are here present today, they are held accountable for the investment decisions made by the General Board of Pension and Health Benefits. If General Conference has never been held accountable for investment decisions because it doesn't make investment decisions. You know, we feel as though that establishing the precedent of General Conference making investment decisions is a very dangerous precedent, because today General Conference may be saying, here are the things that we don't want you to invest in. Tomorrow it may be, here are the things that we do want you to invest in. And to the extent our responsibility is to provide retirement and other benefit services to our participants, we just think it's a very dangerous practice for General Conference to make investment decisions.
Aaron Tiger from Oklahoma. So when is there a time in which divestment is the right strategy?
So our belief is that when a company has business practices that are not sustainable, and that continuation of those unsustainable practices will make the company a bad investment, will lose money on behalf of our participants, that's the time that you should sell. I mean, that's our belief. Yes.
Chapel Temple Dave. I just wanted to thank you for what you're doing, but also to say there will be other petitions coming. Our conference has one that will call for investment in some positive ways, Palestinian projects, for example. Kairos will bring an enormous amount of energy to their presentations. There will be funding for that will come from outside of the UMC. At least there has been in the past. And so I think it's important for everyone here to understand that the UMC is seen as the largest domino that they would like to have fall. If the UMC can be brought to engage in this BDS strategy, the Presbyterians have already done that, the Anglican Church hasn't. That will be a dramatic PR victory for that side. So we are being used as a sort of a pawn in the whole greater issue going on this.
Thank you. I have several comments regarding your statement question. First, what I didn't mention when I talked about the amendment to the resolution in 2012 was that there was language asking us to make positive investments. And we have actively pursued making positive investments. We think we've found something that we can make that is a good investment. We aren't going to do handouts. That's a violation of our fiduciary responsibility. We've made significant attempts to find a viable investment, and we've got a lot of I's to dot and T's to cross. And there have been, in every one up until this one that we're currently evaluating, we've had to dismiss it because it just wasn't a viable investment in the best interest of our participants. So that is something that we have been actively pursuing. In addition, you talked about the Presbyterian Church passing divestment legislation. While the Presbyterian Church did ask for divestment, my counterpart, the chief investment officer for their equivalent of our agency, addressed the body and said, we know that you're considering this legislation. You need to understand, even if you pass it, we can't divest for the same reasons that I talked about, that they are prudent fiduciaries. And in fact, they have not divested from those companies. Now, what they have agreed to is not to purchase any additional shares, although they do have a provision that would allow them to purchase additional shares under certain conditions. Is there anything else? I don't see any other questions, so thank you again very much for giving me the opportunity to speak with you today.
Again, thank you, Dave, for making the effort to come down and to be able to be here. It is a very complex subject, and you will have lots of emotion about it when we get to General Conference. We want you to be prepared. You have been great. Why don't we take 20 minutes, look at your watch, 20 minutes from right now. It'll be a time for you to conference and also have a break. And some of you may need to break and then conference. Whichever way you decide works best for you, but why don't we take 20 minutes from that? We then have a very important presentation you are going to want to hear, and then we'll be having our closing worship.